rational.
Propaganda. Media.
Radio.
Welcome to Rational Propaganda Media Radio. This is your host, Jason and Aaron.
How's everybody?
I am doing excellent tonight, man. Hey, did you get to hear that interview from Lewis Arthur on our last show?
I did.
Cool. That was quite, for me, that was a very interesting interview.
I agree. He seems to be a very interesting person.
Yeah, to be inspired to get out there and actually try to make a positive difference in the world.
Well, I think we could probably all be a little bit more like that, to be honest.
Yeah, I think that's what really excites me most about the story, is that he had a good idea, a pure idea, go out there and help homeless people and homeless veterans. And then he just went out there and just started doing it, regardless of the flack he might have got and the trouble in doing so. But it seems like a very sensible and logic conclusion, because there are a lot of homeless people out there throughout our country that aren't getting the help that they need.
I agree completely.
And it really kind of hits me in a special place when it comes to our veterans, because we rely on those veterans to keep the peace and protect us all in this country of ours. So, regardless on how anyone feels about what the leaders decide to do with our veterans or our foreign policy or anything like that, I have a strong support for our military veterans out there.
I agree completely. I'm the son of a military veteran, the grandson of, actually, on both sides of military veterans. I've got uncles that are military vets. And so, yes, their health and welfare very much is of interest to me.
Yeah, and the future, where it's going, because I see, or at least I hear a lot of stuff. I haven't had any personal experience directly, but I hear how the veteran VA is lacking in helping people that need it.
Yeah, I just saw a story today from Phoenix that the whistleblower, it looks like the people that got her in trouble are not going to be prosecuted or something. So that could be bad.
What are you referring to? The whistleblower? Did they rat out the VA?
Yeah. The ones that ratted them out in Phoenix.
I'm not familiar with the story.
Okay. Well, supposedly, according to the article, there was a lady that, with the help of a doctor in Phoenix, was the one that initiated the whole situation with the VA. I think it was in 2013. So, I guess somebody did an investigation and came back and they found out, we should get rid of these, couple of people that were in the leadership that were trying to hide information and trying to get the whistleblowers in trouble for whistleblowing. And the article said something about the lady that was the initial whistleblower having problems with actually getting anything done at the VA to get those people removed.
Well,
we should actually have the ability to talk bad about our government when there's a situation going on that that needs rectification, like the VA situation, and having veterans die while waiting on a secret list. I mean, that's almost like some kind of you know, fantasy novel or something to imagine that it actually happened.
Yeah, well, so often when I break the skin of a story, not just, you know, what everyone's repeating, the basics and trying to form my own opinion, so I'll search out more information, I find that life is much, much stranger than fiction.
It's
in
true.
Every case. It seems like it's, wow. And, yeah, and that's a shame. And it's hard being a whistleblower today. I don't know why. I don't know why it is. I guess because if they're blowing the whistle on someone, someone's also embarrassed or not wanting that information out.
Yeah, I think that's the big thing about it. You know, for some reason, people believe that, you know, they can't trust a whistleblower because they've gone against their company or whatever agency they work for, you know. But the truth is that whistleblowers are the ones that tell everybody else that there's inherent problems within the system. So, and the whole thing about the VA having secret lists of veterans that, you know, these veterans are dying while they're on this waiting list. It's just, it's phenomenally ridiculous. That, I mean, I'm glad that we had a whistleblower in that case for sure.
It definitely, I don't know what it takes to be a whistleblower, but it definitely seems in every case it's at the cost of a very extreme personal sacrifice.
Yeah, well, being a whistleblower, you basically have to go against the whatever the prevailing attitude is in the corporation or the governmental entity or whatever you're up against, you know. So you're basically taking the ideas of that group and, you know, saying, hey, look, you know, these are the wrong ideas. Which a lot of people don't have that kind of capability of talking up about problems. Right,
well,
whistleblowing.
And let alone put yourself out there on your butt. You know, put your butt out there and get it chewed. Get it chewed.
Yeah, because a lot of whistleblowers suffer severe consequences.
Absolutely, especially in very personal tragedies, such as, you know, something. It's a horrible subject to talk about, and it's a horrible subject to... I couldn't imagine what it'd be to actually go out and put yourself out there and speak the truth when it comes to rape in the military.
Yeah, that was a situation that was going on a couple of years ago, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, and it seems as far as, you know, human nature and rape in itself, it's not exclusive to the military. But it's hard when you speak out as a woman, hey, I got raped, and then it seems like they try to suppress that information and alienate the person, and they lose their career.
Yeah.
A
lot of groups don't want to be, they don't want to be called out because it looks bad on the leadership of the group. You know, rather than wanting the problem to be solved, the leadership is trying to cover it up so it doesn't sully their own name, you know. And especially
yeah.
When it comes to something like a veteran, you know, a person that has served the United States in a foreign war or served in wartime, that's really a heinous crime in my estimation. Because we got to take care of the people, you know, that are willing to go out there and die for the ideals that we hold here in America.
Yeah. Well, it's hard to hold people to higher standards because, especially when it comes to a difficult problem. And it's also a problem with men in the military who get raped. And I can only imagine that's even more difficult because... Men aren't trained to really talk about their feelings.
No.
So it's you know, I think about when we had that conversation with Kuleem Stevens, just being a victim of domestic violence is hard enough to go out and do something about it and not see the urgency. But I did have a chance to look up. I was not aware of the current story. Arizona AZ Central has a story that says VA inspectors reject blame for delayed disciplining of Phoenix executives.
That sounds about right.
Yeah, it looks like the officials who are accountable for it are getting off the hook.
Yeah, that's kind of what I read. They did an investigation, and this lady's been trying to get an update on it forever and a day. And finally, you know, they said, oh, hey, we ditched that investigation like 6 or 8 months ago. That's a hell of a way to find out that they ended the investigation, you know?
Wow. I'm surprised people aren't protesting it.
Yeah. I would be if I was in Arizona, for sure. I'd be out there with you guys.
Well, wow. Well, that just kind of shows where if our officials, our elected officials and leaders, can't take care of our veterans, someone's got to.
Well, it's not just the fact that, you know, the leadership is not going to get in trouble for the whole situation. It's the fact that, you know, they took the whistleblower and basically put her in the basement as a document clerk. You know, so, you know, that's what happened to the whistleblower. And the doctor, I guess, he's not actually working for the VA anymore, so.
The doctor, Sam.
They're helping behind the scenes. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. The doctor.
And there's no telling what really, really happened behind the scenes, you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, I kind of like uncomfortable truth, but I guess, what is it? It was Paula Padin in the Phoenix System Public Affairs Office said her budget was slashed and her staff reduced in 2012 after she raised multiple allegations of misconduct and mismanagement.
Yeah, and that's when they found out about the secret lists and all that stuff. And she, from what I read, she had originally thought that it was limited only to the Phoenix VA, but then it started coming out around the United States. So, it's in more than just the Phoenix VA. And like you said earlier, if we can't take care of our veterans, you know, there's something wrong with us.
Well, I think it's this you know, it's promises. It's making promises with funds that we don't even have right now.
Yeah.
And you know,
that's the government's job, is to take money that it doesn't actually own and use it for its own needs. So.
And it seems to me, I'm not an economist, or, you know, it's not like I'm, you know, super buku educated in it, but it just seems to me that debt is paying for promises today that are going to be owed tomorrow.
Yeah. Unfortunately, it's my niece and nephew that are going to have to pay off all the debts that we're incurring right now.
Yeah, and I don't know. It comes from maybe my personal experience. Not my personal experience, but just my personal perspective on things. It seems like we're having this debt that's going way out of control. We're borrowing money in an unprecedented proportion at this time as a nation, and also as individual states across our whole nation. And it seems at the same time, people are suffering. Yeah. We can't keep these promises. We're having problems with all these systems that are funded by this way across the board.
Well, I think our biggest problem in the United States right now is that, you know, we're trying to fund too many things. You know, I don't disagree at all with helping people that are poor, you know, but to what level do we help? You know, because, I mean, it just ends up going back into taxes and stuff like that anyway. And eventually you've got a system that's completely socialist. So.
Well, that's ever since the New Deal and the New Deal Part 2, that's kind of where we've been heading.
Yeah, I agree.
And it just, it really boggles my mind. Because at the same time, socialists are saying capitalism is the problem. And we probably live in a country with more socialistic attributes than capitalistic.
Yeah, but we're still closer to the capitalistic ideal, definitely, than Europe is. But I mean, the thing is that, you know, because we were on more of a capitalistic bent than Europe, we have actually been the powerhouse forever in a day. The only reason China's fixing to outstrip us is because they have, you know, four times as many people as we do. So.
Well, and they're also, they've adopted more of it. They've gone the route of heading towards capitalism.
Yeah,
and away from
private businesses and stuff like that, yes. So they're actually, I mean, capitalism is just a way where you can just stoke the fires, you know. It's a really good method for just kind of like bringing everybody's income up a little bit. Because, as you can tell, even the lowest among us actually have flat screen TVs right now, it seems like.
Well, I don't know. I really would have to, you know, I think in my own mind, to really be able to have a really good judgment, I would have to spend a little time in China and see how it works out.
Oh, yeah. Well, in China, I mean, if your building fails, you don't get another chance. They just execute you. So there are some disadvantages to China as well, you know? Because the government still does control everything. So anytime they want to tighten the grip, they just do it. Around here, they ask the people, or they say that they ask the people, and then they go ahead and do it anyway. So that's how our government works.
It seems that way, doesn't it? It does seem that way.
Yeah, there used to be a time when you actually had to vote on stuff, you know, but I don't know when that time ended. But now people can just, you know, do whatever they want to unilaterally.
Well, and it's promoted by the people. That's, I guess that's where it boggles me, is like, okay, we have a problem. The blame is on capitalism. So we need more socialism. We need more taxpayer money going into infrastructure. We need, you know, we need to build up the bridges, and like Roosevelt. I hear that sometimes. We need to do what Roosevelt does and spend taxpayer money and job programs, schooling, infrastructure. We need to build our whole economy on taxpayer money.
Yeah, that is definitely a place where you and I are not in complete agreement there, buddy. But, you know, the thing is, I think that, you know, roads are more efficiently done in a public fashion like that, but
you
it's
don't,
possible
you don't,
that I'm wrong.
You don't see that, though?
I've never seen it done in a private way, so.
But
I've
I mean, you don't.
Never seen it done by a private corporation.
You don't see that people are promoting basically, essentially, let's fix our economy by using taxpayer money to do it in whatever programs, government jobs, you know, we're talking about.
Oh, you're talking about the shovels
work
in the ground kind of stuff. Yeah. Yeah, the government doesn't actually make money. The people make money and they give it to the government. So the government
right.
actually makes the people's money.
So I wish there was someone who could really explain the logic, how we're going to prosper through fixing our messed up economy through public works, basically anything that's funded through collecting taxes. And why would someone promote raising my taxes when our leaders are already horrible with money? You know?
Yeah, they're very bad. I mean, if this had been a family situation with Congress, you know, and the president and everything, it would already be, they'd already be in bankruptcy. So, but luckily the government can print its own money, you know, that's how they keep afloat. If they go, oh, hey, I can print $1 million more. I can print, you know, well, they don't print $1 million. They print $1 billion at a time. But still, you know, they just print their own money and then, like, hey, we got $1 billion.
What is the current running statistic? Is it $1 billion a day, or it's a lot of money?
Yeah, I don't think it's our economy runs, what is it, like $1.2 trillion a year or something like that. I mean, it's in the trillions. It's not actually in the billions, as far as what the government actually spends, because the the military side of the budget, I'm not sure how accurate these figures are because I haven't actually looked lately, but I remember a figure like $600 billion at some point in time recently. So, and I'm guessing that the social programs are at least another $600 billion. That'd make it $1.2 trillion a year the government's putting out.
Well, I'm looking at a chart here from the National Priorities Project.
Good.
You can see
better figures than mine.
Well, yeah, because we're kind of speculating. I mean, we have a general idea of what's going on. You can look at this information at nationalpriorities.org. I'm looking at just a simple chart of United States 2015 budget. So this is just the budget, where the money comes from.
Right, and then they have the deficit, which is where we go over the budget, or under it, which is very
low,
but still.
It says that it's $3.8 trillion in revenue and borrowing. And that's for 2015. Tax revenues and federal funds equal $2.5 trillion. And what that breaks down is, it breaks down that $2.5 trillion that our government pulls in that people want to anxiously spend to fix our economy comes from individual income taxes, which is only $1.48 trillion. Or that's, I guess,
that's
the majority.
You mean they spend like $5 trillion a year?
Huh?
Is that... What's the total on that? Like $5 trillion?
The tax revenue, okay, the total revenue and
the whole revenue,
is $3.8 trillion. So $3.08.
Okay, so if they go $400 billion or $40 billion over that, then it's $3.84 trillion. So that's just a ridiculously amazing number.
I'll send you real quick what I'm looking at so you you can see it for yourself.
That's 3.8 times 10 to the 12th. So that's 12 euros after this. That's a lot of money. That's why they cut it off at the millions usually.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm looking at here. And so it's $3.8 trillion in revenue and borrowing. Now, the tax revenue, federal funds, is $2.5 trillion. And that breaks down mostly in individual income taxes of $1.48 trillion. Then you have corporate income taxes of 342 billion. So we went from trillions, now we're just talking about billions. There's about 156 billion in what's called others. And then we have custom duties, which is 35 billion, and excise taxes, 38 billion. So those are about the same.
So that's 55% of its total revenue. This is a really cool chart. You ought to put this up on the website.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, put it up on the Facebook, man. Let people see
it. I'll put it up right away. I'll put it up right away. Yeah, it's a very good chart, and it definitely, if you can look at that chart, I mean, as long as you don't, if you can stay open-minded enough not to already form your opinion before looking at the chart and then come to your own conclusions before actually thinking, but you actually think about it and you go, okay, we also get tax revenues and trust funds, which is Social Security and Medicare taxes.
Yay. You know what that means, right? That means that the $18 trillion debt that we already got going on would take the government 5 years to pay off. Five full years for it to spend tax money on nothing else.
Yeah. If we quit funding everything, right? We just collected taxes to pay off the debt.
Right. We just collected the money.
In a weird scenario.
Right. Then after about 4.5 years, that's 16. Yeah, so that would be 18. 4.5 years would be about 18 trillion. But then, well, we're still running over, so it's probably only 19 trillion. I don't know, man. That's like 4.5, 5 years just, you know, collecting money just to pay off the deficit. Now, the thing is, there is an advantage to it. If we let it go,
sure.
And
we can afford things we
can't
afford.
Anymore,
I'm sorry.
Well, if
go
we
ahead.
Let it go and we don't raise the deficit anymore, I'm sorry, we don't raise the national debt anymore, then the situation will be that eventually we'll catch up with it, like 150 years from now, right? Because eventually our economy will be hot enough, it'll be big enough that $18 trillion due to inflation will be almost nothing. But that requires us to stop spending over what we're actually taking in at this point in time. You know? So.
I know, and it's nuts. It's nuts. We borrow, 16% of our revenue is in borrowing. $583 billion. Okay? Now, so this is in 1 year. We borrow $583 billion. Then we have to service the interest on the debt. So we pay $229 billion just to service the debt. So we're borrowing, like, maybe break it down to numbers that I can understand. It's like a household borrowing $583 billion a year, every year, let's say, you know, not 100% accurate, but $583 a year, and then in that year they pay $229 just to service the debt. Following year they borrow another $500 or $600,
I think that's actually gone down, but the bad thing about it is it's still in the red, so
yeah,
we're not actually solving the problem as we go along.
It just doesn't make any sense.
Spending too much money, man. That's the problem.
No,
we need to
fix our economy by using more money that we don't have to pay for schools and pay for job programs, pay for infrastructure, pay for all these additional things, because people are suffering. And if we can't get it in tax money, we're going to make those rich businesses suffer by forcing them by law to pay people more.
Yeah, but people are suffering, you're right, because the thing is, you know, you used to be able to create a business and not have the government all over your back all the time about everything.
This is authoritarian. This is, you know, when someone tells you how you're going to spend your money and how they're going to tax you more, and how we're going to tell businesses to pay people more because people are suffering without understanding a thing about finances, without even considering what this simple chart of what we're looking at and put it down to a perspective like our probably not so accurate scenario, but how does a household work? You know? Then you're going, wait a minute, if this was my household finances, I'd be saying, look here, wife, we can't keep spending money we don't have. And if we keep borrowing another $6,000 a year or maybe $600 a year, and then we pay a little less than half of it just to throw our money away in interest.
Yeah, that's pretty much what that is.
Eventually, it's going to catch up with us. And then what happens is at the same time that we're borrowing this money and we're bringing in all this money, all these services, Social Security, Medicare, veterans benefits, promises, food assistance, unemployment, all these systems are suffering. Can we not deny that our transportation and all this stuff that we're funding can we all agree, whether no matter what political stance, that all these programs are not working like they're intended?
Well, the real problem is when the mandatory spending exceeds the income, because then that means that we are mandated to spend money that we don't actually have.
Well,
right now it's a 65-29 split. Oh, and we're paying 6% on the interest. So
you bring up a really good point. We have a revenue of 55% is our revenue, which is $2.5 trillion and that's tax revenue in federal funds.
The rest of it is actually income revenue. You know, the tariffs and all that stuff are still revenue. They're not from actual taxes. They're from other means.
Yeah, but if you just take individual income tax, corporate tax, others, and custom duties, excise tax, and you put it all together, that's $2.5 trillion. Now, we've made promises. We have a mandatory spending, and our mandatory spending is is New Deal spending. It's not constitutional. We've already, leaders before I was born, already promised this money. And it's
Medicare and health, Social Security, food assistance and unemployment, and then other programs. It's actually $400 billion more than we take in tax revenue.
I know.
Just the mandatory spending.
It's $2.45 trillion. How many billion more is that?
$400 billion more dollars. Almost half a trillion dollars more than we take in taxes.
So if we took our current corporate income tax, it still wouldn't pay $400 billion. We only make $342 billion in corporate income tax.
Yeah,
and
we're not even
talking about our discretionary spending. So mandatory spending is 65% of spending. So 65% of our budget goes to Medicare, health, Social Security, other food assistance, unemployment.
Think of it like this. The mandatory spending is like your rent, your electricity, you know, stuff that you have to have to actually make the budget, you know? So, as far as mandatory being, you know, something that's already, the government has already promised that it's going to spend.
Well, and it's mandatory spending, you know.
Right, it's not
really
technically mandatory, but it's been promised to something like Social Security or Medicare and stuff like that.
What they mean by mandatory is they are unable to change that. They're unable to cut that out of the budget. Mandatory spending basically is locked in stone. we need to spend $2.4 trillion a year, or at least in the budget of 2015, without changing it. That can't be changed. Now, discretionary.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is, if you somehow shifted Social Security to another method or something like that, you could actually. So it's not technically mandatory. It's just something that the government wants to spend, you know, because the programs that they already have in place. So technically,
right.
It's not mandatory. It's actually discretionary, but people call it mandatory because they don't. I don't know that they know what they're talking about. It's not
mandatory. I think mandatory spending. Let me do a quick little search on that. But mandatory. I believe that just basically means we can't fudge the budget on that stuff.
Well, the deal is, you know, if we want to keep Medicare going on the way that it is right now, then we have to do the mandatory spending. But if we choose to change Medicare into something else or modify Medicare in some way, then we can actually save money on the mandatory spending. And it's technically not mandatory in that case.
Well, this is what Wikipedia says. I did a quick search. The United States fiscal policy, mandatory spending is spending on certain programs that are required by existing law. In the United States, mandatory refers to a budget authority that ensues outlays provided in laws other than Appropriations Act, including annual appropriation. Appropriated entitlements. So I assume the appropriated entitlements would be education, housing and community, international affairs.
Medicare, all those are technically mandatory. But the deal is that if you change one of those ideas, if you shift, for example, if you shift Social Security over to the private sector, part of Social Security, then that will no longer be coming out of the mandatory fund. You see what I'm trying? You see what I'm saying?
Yeah, but it looks like Social Security and Medicare generates $1.07 trillion.
Right.
But at the same time, it costs $895 billion for Social Security, and then of course Medicare and health is $986 billion. Is that close to $1 trillion? Once it goes.
Yeah, well, Social Security and the Medicare taxes, it says bring in $1.07 trillion, and Social Security and Medicare and health send out more than $1.7 trillion. So that once again is going actually over, you know, the actual income from the tax revenue for Medicare and Social Security taxes. See, what they did is they put it together up here and they separated it down there. So.
Okay. So it's almost.
My gosh.
It's
almost $2 trillion.
It's almost $2 trillion, but it only brings in just over $1 trillion.
Right. So right now it's sucking a good $800 to $900 billion out of our actual funds for the government.
Wow.
That's
yeah,
just Social Security and Medicare.
This boggles my mind. I look at this, and we haven't even had a talk of discretionary spending, military spending. $598 billion, so about $600 billion.
Yeah.
Billion.
I think
that's just discretionary.
I think you and I probably would disagree a little bit on that. But I think it's necessary for the guardianship of the United States of America.
Oh, no,
that we stay ahead of the next guy
in line. I definitely believe in a strong national offense. Defense, not offense. I said offense. believe in a strong national defense. I do not believe in a strong national offense. There's a big difference, but that's another program. Another radio program. But it's the discretionary spending, which is military, other, education, housing and community, international affairs, energy and environment, and transportation, which makes up 29% of spending, is $1.11 trillion versus our $2.45 mandatory spending.
See, so, once again, I put that mandatory in quotation marks. It's mandatory only because we choose it to be mandatory.
Well, it's currently law. Basically, this is the thing. We would have to change our current laws or reform them before we can not be required by law to pay that. And all people are asking, or not all people, but it seems like our country is divided because one half who doesn't think critically about this money situation is going, we need to add to our mandatory spending and pay for education and pay for all these other things.
We already pay a lot of money for education and other things. It's just that the money that the government spends is not efficient money.
But people are suffering. Don't you understand, Eric?
The money that filters through the government filters through 50 levels of bureaucracy before it gets anywhere. You know? So what ends up, you put in a buck and you get out 5 cents at the end. It's very inefficient way to do things.
Well, so, it definitely
seems
that way.
Well,
we're just looking at this one chart. You're coming up to conclusions. You're trying to rationalize this.
Yeah, I'm trying to make more coffee, but you know.
To me, this to me, and I could be wrong. I mean, I would be more than happy to be open-minded to hear why I would be wrong in saying this and kind of try to rationalize why I'm incorrect. But to me, it seems like if you look at the budget and you don't understand why people are suffering, it's because our leaders up there don't know how to manage our money.
I agree.
My fear
they're
is
really
it,
bad, and people want to give them more. They want to give them more money to mismanage. I mean, how much money does it take to mismanage all the money that we have in the United States? You know.
Hey, look, you know, it just seems to me as what happened in Detroit is basically happening on a national level, and I want to be wrong on that. I definitely. Well, why would I want more and more cities to systematically go bankrupt in my country, you know?
Well, the problem is, I think that, and this is a very sad case, but I think that we might actually have to have it happen before people realize that it's not a good idea.
You mean so, we it's like an addiction?
Yeah, well, the problem with Europe, and the reason Europe goes, and once again, my opinion, man, I've got plenty of them if you ever want to hear all of them. But one of the big deals about Europe is it doesn't really have a lot of discretionary spending per se. So as you go more socialist, more costs are actually built in. You know, they're not allowed to be moved around. You know, they're mandatory as opposed to discretionary. So therefore, you have less ability for the economy to actually move from one into the other as, for example, recessions come along and, you know, depressions and stuff like that. And what ends up happening is without a mobile economy, like a more capitalistic economy, you get wrapped up in stuff and your economy suffers more when you have these downward trends as well as the upward trends. Okay, so your downward trends may not be quite as bad, but your upward trends aren't as high either. It's more of a plateau kind of situation. You know what I mean?
Yeah. I don't know. It just seems like if the majority of people understood, or I guess let me not understood. If the majority of people cared enough about this, our budget, and how we spend money, it would seem like our leaders would have to change what they've been doing.
Yeah.
But
well, they've been in 60, 70 years now. I don't think it's going to change anytime soon.
Well,
the problem
obviously,
is, like you said,
they're used to the money coming in. It's like a college. And that book we're reading, the book we're reading, they kind of explain how it's like a college kid going off to college the first time and just spending like crazy.
Well, I think the biggest problem that you're going to have, that you're going to run into, is a situation where if, for example, if our credit rating as a nation, if the United States credit rating goes down, then it's going to cost us more interest to pay on the bills that we already have. So if we end up defaulting on the rating several times, then our rating will go down, our amount of interest that we pay will balloon, and then you've got a problem, because then the interest goes from $200 billion, you know, up to $800 billion.
Well, you don't have a problem if you're the one getting the interest payments.
Right, right. Well, we owe those. A lot of people say, hey, we owe those to ourselves. And in some ways we do. But those people, you know, they have a right to their money too. They invested their money in the United States of America with the promise that they'd get it back with interest.
I think in the back of their minds, because, you know, if you think about it, oh, well, government needs to pay for school, whatever program. We need to add more programs, more government spending. Basically, you know, the way I see it, the way you see it, that means we need to spend more tax money. We need to tax more. But I think
I wouldn't have so much of a problem. Like you were saying earlier, you know, education, I wouldn't have so much of a problem with spending a little bit of money to educate kids, as long as the teachers union, you know, you really can't negotiate with them. So that kind of forms a problem when you've got a whole slew of people that want to fight against, you know, lowering taxes and stuff like that. Then they'll vote on one side consistently, keep their own, you know, income high while everybody else suffers. So.
Well,
I don't have anything against teachers. I had a lot of good teachers growing up, but I don't like the unions at all.
I agree with you. I don't have a problem with teachers. Usually they do. They're like soldiers. They do it for the right reason.
They're like policemen.
Right, but just like companies abuse their workers, and then we needed unions. I think we've probably gone to a point where the unions are now so big that they actually abuse the companies.
Well,
and neither
the unions
is acceptable.
Also abuse the union members.
Right.
I don't know if you ever had a chance to be a part of a union when you were up in Rockford.
No.
But, oh, man.
No, no unions. No, bad word.
when I was in Louisville, we did have actually some unions there. And they were talking about, oh, yeah, the union members would beat up people trying to cross the line to actually go to work. But, well, you know, the big thing about it is unions, I think they outgrew themselves. You know what I mean? Now, will there come a day again when unions may be necessary? Probably. But
well,
the easy thing to do is just to recreate the unions when we need them rather than have them up all the time. Because the unions actually... They kind of have bad situations with the members of the union themselves. It's the heads of the unions that actually make all the money.
Yeah.
And the people underneath.
It seems like that's a common theme nowadays where, you know, unrational
people at the top
propaganda.
Make all the money.
Yeah, unrational propaganda. We're promoting policies and giving power to the guys that it's a small group of guys that benefit or a small group of people that actually benefit, but the majority seems to be like, yeah, we can't have injustice and all this other stuff. So they promote policies that actually adds to the injustice and benefits a small group of rich people, power-hungry rich people. I think maybe my simpleton way is the absolute power corrupts absolutely scenario. You know, my way of summing up a very complex idea into a simplified form.
Well, I think that's been the problem.
And, you know, Bernie
Sanders.
We've
allowed.
Oh, go ahead.
Go ahead.
Oh, I was going to say, Bernie Sanders says that, oh, no, I get my funds from the people. You know, I don't get funds from lobbyists and big interests. But all of his funds, a lot of his funds, the larger majority of his gains come from big interest unions.
Yeah.
And I don't see that, like you pointed out, I share the same perspective of you as far as the way you kind of see unions, where they abuse their members for big money. But
vice presidents and the union presidents that make all the money, and they actually make the decisions for the entire union.
And,
so they make it hard for individual members to vote in any way other than what the union wants to do. I don't like that either.
So. Well, and it's just kind of a shame, because I see people are suffering. And the other thing is then we got a situation like what Lewis Arthur is trying to do. He's going out there on his own and saying, okay, forget all this crazy crap. People need help. This complex, mundane system of rational and unrational propaganda and sending money to organizations that end up growing out to be corrupt and hurting people more than helping them, he's going to go out there and just do what he's been trained to do as a veteran and go out and help people.
Well, see, that's what we need more of, is people that actually, rather than, you know, want to send all their money to the government to have it rerouted to the people that need it, they actually go out there and do something for the people that need it themselves. That's always been the way that I've thought that it should happen.
Well, we need to be finding time. We're too busy paying taxes, maybe, and going into debt and paying interest payments, and, you know.
That's what I could do. If I ever get a chance to come over and visit you, man, we'll go out and do some charity work and stuff, just because we can.
Yeah, I'd rather just get a credit card and we can just go out
send
and have
it to
a
the
good
government.
Time. Yeah, we'll help people with, we'll help people by getting a credit card, and we'll just throw money at them. We won't spend any real quality time helping. We won't do that at all. Matter of fact, wait a minute. I see we have our distinguished guest on. He's going to be coming in now. I'm going to bring on our guest, Lewis Arthur, someone who doesn't need to rely on money to get something done. He actually goes out there and does what our leaders and our people who don't know how to manage money is, and he's doing it without the support of city or federal funding. Lewis, are you here?
Yes, I'm sorry for being late. You know how it gets when you got these fires to put out a base, so I got just here in time. Sorry about that.
No worries on being late. You might have to share the spotlight with Ken Lee when he calls. But
how's it going, Ken?
He's not here yet, but he should be calling here shortly. We're almost hitting the hour, so what we'll do is we'll be taking a musical interlude here pretty soon and play a few promos, and we can talk off air at that point. But Ken will be calling here after the musical interlude. I've visited the camp twice now. And
yes,
you
sir.
Are one busy man. I don't. I
understand.
I was lucky to sit down with you for an hour. Because before I sat down with you and we did the video interview, you were up doing this and doing that and going over here and making sure this was taken care of. And then after the interview, you went back to working your butt off for a lot less than $15 an hour that people want to mandate.
Yeah, well.
Yeah.
What keeps you
going? I like
that
video. It was a good video.
Well, I do want to give you, let you guys know that, some of the people who might call in or want to listen to the podcast later or whatever, Thursday night we are launching Delta Base in Sierra Vista. We're going in with the team Christmas Eve. We're going undercover at night. We're going to set up a base and a location. Now, there are Sierra Vista families that know the location. It's very limited. These are just individuals of certain motorcycle clubs and associations and groups at the leadership levels of these groups. They know where we're going to be at. They know where to send everyone. Thursday night around 9 o'clock, we'll have a lot of the bikers and families come up in Sierra Vista. By then, we should have our first few structures set up. By Christmas morning, we start sending out the search and remember teams. And we go out and send out our foot patrols. We march with our flags. And we pull in all of the vets in the area out to Delta Base. And then we have them spend Christmas Day with us out there camping in the desert.
Ah, and what's this base going to be called?
It's Delta. Because
Delta.
We have Alpha's going to be rebuilt in Mesa after the first of the year. And we'll make sure we have the right team in place to stick with the protocols that you don't set up fundraisers, you don't solicit money, we don't file for a nonprofit. We don't need to seek permission, ask anyone's authority to go out and help someone and do a good thing. We don't, you know, there's no law that I see justifiable that would prevent me from going out to feed my neighbor, help my neighbor, shelter my neighbor. You know, that's between me and my neighbor, and the government has no business between me and my neighbor.
I completely agree with you on that.
Yeah, they're really horrible with money, and we were talking about how there's some stuff going on with the Phoenix VA where our veterans aren't getting help.
Well, it's not so much as... money. I mean, I still believe, like most others, that the VA is underfunded. I think we overfund in areas where we shouldn't. We shouldn't be funding the pharmaceuticals the tunes of billions of dollars to turn our returning combat veterans into a bunch of zombies by doping them up with psychotropics and making them addicted to codeine and Oxycontin and everything else. That's not a solution. You don't give a person a pill for their problem when you can have a person, a people, coming together that can solve the problem. Someone giving a damn about them, if you look at the money we spend, the money that's misappropriate, especially through the military industrial complex, I mean, it's failure at all levels. And in order for us to change it, we first have to acknowledge that we have a problem. Well, a lot of us, we all agree we have a problem. There's a lot of failures in our government. It's deeply corrupt. It's untrustworthy at this point, as far as so many of us are concerned. You know, but we also have common sense, and we know that we're not going to go start a revolution, and the American people aren't going to allow their daily conveniences to be taken away from them, like their phones and their electricity and their, you know, running water. You know, I mean... revolution and talk of open war against the government, things of that nature, that's not how you change it. You also can't change it by becoming a politician and becoming part of the corrupted system. We've seen so many good people get elected, and there were patriots going in, and now they're complete traitors. You know, and, you know, everything that they ran on their platform, they just lied. And we have liars leading the nation. We have the fewest amount of warfighters leading Congress in the history of our country. And that's part of the reason why we have so many problems in our government, is we don't have the right leadership. You know, we don't. And we need the leadership of our returning soldiers, our combat veterans. We need the leadership of our military. We need to engage them more into our community. And active duty has been great. The bases out here have been awesome. They keep us supplied. They come out and volunteer. You know, they come out and feed. We have some that'll help supply us locations of camps to go and do recon to see if there's any homeless vets in those areas. I mean, there's active duty down here participating within the community. There's law enforcement volunteering their time, participating within the community. You know, and so we need to get more of the community, more of the Patriots, more of the churches, all the nonprofits, everybody just to take a pause and help us get out here in this state. You know, help us go cover as much area as possible. Help us find every homeless veteran in the state of Arizona. Help us build something in each community that's going to benefit everyone, not just one particular group or special interest. And I'm sorry, I'm looking at some maps here right now. What time did you say Ken was coming on?
We got Ken on the on hold here. So I'm going to go into a promo and a musical interlude. I'll take us all off into a so we can have an off-air chat. And then we'll come back and then we'll hear from Ken Lee and we'll find out how... what he's doing what's called a Panhandlers Co-op, and he's also working with Lewis here in Bravo Base. So we'll hear more about that when we come back after our brief musical interlude. And Lewis, thank you for coming on the radio show, but really, thank you for going out there and doing where our local and federal governments seem to be lacking. Thanks for picking up that slack, sir.
Well,
much respect on that.
Yeah, I would advise everybody this, though. I mean, at some point, we're going to have to stop pointing our fingers at government's failure, at local government's failure. If you step back and look, the community doesn't engage. All they do is they go push a voter ballot box and they wait for the next round of elections for the appointed people to tell them who to vote for, and then they do the same thing. They don't engage. They're not part of the process of the policies and the laws and the regulations that get written on a daily basis that restrict freedoms. They don't know what's going on. The government's not transparent. It has secret meetings. You know, these things need to change. But we're going to have to stop pointing the fingers at them when we've already proven that we can get out and make a difference without them, you know. And it's not so much as in-your-face government. It's, you know, there's right and wrong. And the way they're going about doing it and their priorities, they're all wrong. We don't prioritize refugees. We don't prioritize non-Americans over the American veterans and the warfighters who go over there and fight for our country. We prioritize. We love everyone. We help everyone. But we take care of our own first. Yeah, that's a must. No matter what, you take care of your own first. And we're not taking care of them. So we need people to set aside all the politics and the BS and get out here and help us take care of them.
And we don't need a violent revolution. If we need a revolution, we need a revolution of love and caring and compassion. I agree with you 100% what you said, Lewis.
Rational.
So,
propaganda.
We'll be back.
Media.
Radio. Rational.
Propaganda. Media.
Radio.
And we're back. And unfortunately, Lewis had to run off. He had some stuff he needed to take care of there at the camp. And as he was mentioning, he's going to set up a new base. So there's quite a lot of planning and work to be done. I've been out there twice. I actually went out there yesterday to celebrate Christmas in support of the veterans. Went out there, had an excellent meal. We got to have Santa Claus come out there. I got to talk to a few people I knew and met a few people that spend a lot of time out there. Just excited to be out there helping people. So I want to thank Lewis. He's not with us anymore at this time. But Lewis, many thanks for coming on the show. Good luck going forward and in the future, sir. Much respect for the core values and the ideas and coming up with this.
I agree. Thank you.
One of the gentlemen I got to have the pleasure in enjoying Christmas there at Bravo Base yesterday was someone I had talked to before, Ken Lee. Ken Lee, welcome to the show, sir.
Thank you for having me on.
An absolute pleasure, an absolute pleasure. You are a homeless activist, and you are yourself, you live on the streets as well?
I am homeless.
You are homeless. Okay, so you spend your time homeless, but then you also spend a lot of time trying to help people and try to make life a little better for the Tucson area homeless. Is that about that right?
You could say we're all in it together. And life is easier when we're working together. And so I work to find decent, strong, quality people to work with out here, there's no shortage of people stepping up to work together on the project we're involved in.
Okay. Well, before we get into this project that you've started on your own, I wanted to know what were you do? You have been working with Arthur Lewis there a little bit at Bravo Base. What's your thoughts on what you've seen and what in your dealings?
Well, I have not been doing a lot of work with Arthur, but I do what I can to make people aware of the resource he's made of himself. I really admire what Arthur Lewis is doing and what anybody's doing, but specifically this Veterans on Patrol, they are doing the day in, day out work of finding homeless veterans and working to either support them as best they're able, or if they want help or want off of the street, to get them off the street. And I think that's spectacular. I like his style. I like that, his courage and commitment. It's not well supported by local authorities, but he's kept a collaborative, approach and attitude that has him even getting supports where nobody would have thought it was possible. I really admire what he's doing.
So he's a very he strikes me as one of the most open-minded people I have one of the most open people I have talked to. Do you agree with that?
Yeah. I mean, he up front, I'd like many others, Veterans on Patrol, they're veterans and there are armed people involved in securing the camp and doing some of the patrols that they do, and it looks very much like, militia movement type activity. And,
so are we talking like visual anti?
I'm sorry?
Are we talking like if I went out there and I saw them patrolling armed, are they like, would it strike me that they were visual antis?
Perhaps on its face, that was a concern that many people shared as soon as they started hearing about veterans on patrol. But in fact, once you look at what's happening, not at all. It very much looks like, the sort of straightforward missionary work that, delivers resources to people in need and coordinates community support to make that happen. And it's been refreshing, because up front I had some of, like you'd asked, is it vigilante stuff? And people were saying, oh my, they're armed, and oh goodness, they're militia folk. And well, everybody has a stripe in surviving and building community. And the men and women that I've seen working with Lewis, are doing that. And that's, you talked about Lewis being open-minded. It's taken some open-mindedness on other people's part too, but that's really what we need to, some of the most important work I think we need to do.
Okay, so you kind of say now that you've actually gone down there, got a firsthand experience and see what it's like. You do see the positive impact, the open mindedness, and your fear is of guns being involved doesn't lead you to believe maybe your preconceived notions on what was going on. Is that about an accurate statement?
Yeah. I mean, if we I'd agree with that statement.
Okay.
You know, our preconceived notions are were generally false, and I wanted to get a look at and a snoot full of what they were doing there, and I've been pleased and impressed. I appreciate. I've told others that they say, "Oh, but they're because there'd been some buzz about it. They're armed, and I'm not sure I like that idea." But I don't know who else. Well, there was nobody else that had the courage at that moment to stand up, establish a camp in the face of pretty firm government opposition, local government opposition, and say, we are doing this humanitarian work. We're doing this work of looking after veterans. And I don't know and looking after homeless people beyond just veterans. And there was no one else with the courage and commitment to do so that they had it.
Someone with the strength.
Pardon me?
Someone with the strength and also putting himself, I mean, he's living out there. He's made it into a complete lifestyle. And that's quite a sacrifice. Yeah, I think it's just an amazing story. But you have a pretty neat story in yourself, because where Lewis is trying to create a positive impact in the world we're living in today and helping our most needy in our country, our homeless, you've started something in yourself, and it seems to be, both are pretty new, and it seems to be working out pretty well for the both of you. You have the Can Handlers Co-op? Is that what it's called?
Yes, sir. Can Handlers Co-op. Yeah, we're a cooperative of mostly homeless men and women recyclers. And the beauty of it, it's been relatively, I mean, it's been a lot of work, but it's been relatively easy in that we're organizing around just supporting and lifting up what people are already doing. So it's not as if we're organizing to get people to do anything other than what they're already involved in doing, which is the hard work of intercepting recyclable materials on the way to the landfill and doing that to sustain our livelihood.
Okay. Yeah. So, but now you're kind of trying to help organize that. I was told yesterday that you actually got a license now to sell recyclables. Is that?
Oh, it's not sell recyclables. It's a scrap dealer's license. So we are registered with the state of Arizona as scrap dealers. It was something we had to do. They've gotten very strict about making sure scrap dealers are licensed and registered, and we've made sure that we dotted the I's and crossed the T's and to be able to operate legitimately.
So the transparency's there. They know who you are. They know you're out there. Because in homeless communities across our whole nation, there's people who actually break the law and steal copper from various places.
It is a big part of why they've become very strict about ensuring that scrap dealers register. In fact, that registration was simply involved signing up with an online resource for law enforcement to track down mostly copper thieves. Now, the reporting requirements have become onerous. You need thumbprints, pictures, picture IDs, registration and license plates from the vehicles that are driven in. You need photographs of all the stuff that's recycled with an acceptance, and it is the acceptance that we operate in. Used beverage containers don't require all of the reporting that is required for every other type of scrap buying.
So like aluminum cans and such?
Aluminum cans and number one plastic beverage containers.
Okay.
Yep.
Well, that's great. I mean, and one of the things I really find exciting about this movement that you've organized, Ken, is that it gives people an alternative other than theft or black market to generate some funds. You're actually helping generate honest buck instead of maybe what people's only options is if you don't have a job and you're homeless and maybe you've had other problems that are more restricting you from doing something honestly, it seems like there's not a lot of options out there other than collecting aluminum.
It's really a challenge. There are many people that whether by personal choice we incarcerate so many people in our society that there are many people out here who are collecting cans to make a living, who can't get jobs and have a very difficult time getting a house. And it's not the best living, but it's something. And we're working to both lift that up so the public sees this is what homeless men and women are industriously doing in their community, but also to improve the lot of men and women doing this work. We need to get at the rich sources of recyclable material that is en route to the landfill that is not intercepted, that companies say, oh, we just can't afford to separate all this. We can't afford to do this. And there's a lot of it. There's we're spending millions of dollars on landfill space, and a lot of that space is used for material that needs to be recycled. And we have volunteers ready to step up for those tasks that companies can't afford to do. And I understand
volunteers. Volunteers,
yeah,
so they're,
yeah, I say
they're, wow.
I say volunteers. They're men and women who will gladly, let me use an example. We have some recycling programs in town that have, you know, there's cans that say recycle and cans that say landfill. And all of them go to the landfill. The
and you're talking about
are,
aluminum, right?
Aluminum and number one plastic. And by volunteers, I'm talking about men and women who will step up to do that sorting just for the aluminum and the plastic that they can glean in the process. It will enrich their lives. It's not really a volunteer effort, but when companies or organizations say, we can't afford to sort all this out, we can't pay anyone to sort all that out, we have people who will step up and do it just for the material that they can gather in the process.
With aluminum,
more payday.
Mm-hmm. With aluminum, I know to recycle that actually is one of the only, you know, things that can actually generate income, where you have cardboard and plastics and other recyclables that actually cost money to recycle these things. Because of the high cost of, like you mentioned, you have to sort it, and then you have to melt it down, and then turn it into a product that they can use to make more plastic and bottles. So it sounds like you guys must be working for pennies on the dollar.
Do you mean the people that are doing most of the recycling, or do you mean the people
the
in our organization that are
like yourself?
Yeah, mostly,
I mean, I can't imagine you're raking in a ton of money or anything doing this. You're probably making a lot less than minimum wage.
At this point, we've been at this since July, and it has been a wholly volunteer effort. We have not taken a draw. We have not taken a draw, and you know, it's really a testament to the commitment and passion of the people that have stepped up to volunteer. But it's not that there is not open expectation to be compensated for this work. It's a lot of work, and there is money to compensate us for this work. It's just, you know, it will take a bit for the community to become aware of our project, and our community is so committed to recycling. So
yeah.
Generous and decent that we will have recyclables pouring in to underwrite this project, and I have no doubt about that.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. I'm you know, faith in humanity is very important to me, because we live in a very good but also very terrible world. Is this effort, now you've been doing it for 6 months, say on an average day, how much stuff do you collect that you've gathered?
We're averaging close to 300 pounds of aluminum a week.
What? 300 pounds of aluminum?
Yeah,
a
and
week?
That's Yeah, that's not huge. It really is.
But it still is.
You know, it's a considerable bit of work too. What we do to ensure that that our little seed fund used to purchase this aluminum doesn't wither away is we crush all the aluminum cans top down and glean an additional dime per pound that enables the little fund we use to grow.
Amazing. Well, Ken, hats off to you, sir. I appreciate that. Your honest effort is helping our environment. And,
yes, I think it's real exciting. We've got an opportunity to demonstrate that the efforts of homeless men and women are providing the leadership we need to really build a sustainable future. There aren't others stepping up to volunteer in this, to dig through dumpsters and dig through garbage cans to separate recyclables out, except the homeless men and women who, for the most part, many of them have been doing it all of our lives. I think it's if we can show, for example, that we can make any size dent in the amount of material that is going to the landfills now that we haven't had access to, if we can demonstrate any amount of reduction of material, recycling of material going to the landfill, that'll be huge. All we have to do at that point is scale up, and cities can save money. Homeless men and women can have, richer, more paydays. Well, and a greater sense of purpose. People's sensibilities, how they feel and think about homeless men and women in the community can change.
Yeah, it
is about dignity. And
generating, I know you mentioned it's not really generating any funds, but the idea is you're generating an honest buck out there and providing a service that we need and that people in general care about.
Yeah. And the people I'm working with it's not the only way in which they are serving, playing a leadership role. Taken on the whole, homeless men and women mostly walk, ride the bicycle, or take mass transit. They use dramatically less electricity than most of the rest of the population. They are using clothing that has been discarded,
recycling
much more
clothing
than most. Some don't like the word recycling food, but many of the seeds and much of the work of the food banks in every city in our country involves getting food to hungry people that otherwise can't be sold or served anymore. So the ways in which waste is being repurposed to sustain homeless men and women is, are manifold and do serve as the strongest, clearest model to use. When I talk to our can handlers about this, they'll interrupt me and tell me, well, I got to do this to survive. Well, Tucson has to do this to survive. The United States has to do this to survive. Our species really has to do this to survive. And I feel privileged to be a part of taking advantage of this opportunity to lift up for people that this, so many people talk about the homeless problem, and those problems are the same problems everyone in our culture shares, no matter which demographic you look at. And it's not that they're not, that they don't exist, the problems people use when they're talking about this, but there are some very important, there's some very important leadership out here on the street that's happening that we need to wake up to and embrace and support. It's fun to be a part of doing that, of sharing that.
Well, I think that is very important, and lifting up poor people. I find very good virtues in helping the most needy people in our society, because it may be just philosophical, but it seems like if we lift up the people who need it the most, we're only going to lift ourselves up in the long run.
Amen. Yeah.
And as far as survival, is there what other options do you have to generate an honest buck if you're living on the street? I wouldn't have that experience. I've been fortunate enough never to be in that situation, but is there other ways to generate an honest buck other than, asking people for help?
It all involves interacting with others and finding, ways to serve others. This morning I went, I went to refill my water bottle at a convenience store, and a friend of mine who lives out here on the street was busy picking up this parking lot, and now I don't exactly know how he was being compensated, but he said, "Yeah, I'm just getting some work in, and it's an honest buck he was earning." I'm not exactly sure what he was earning.
Maybe an honest buck paid under the table, but an honest buck nevertheless. Honest by all sense and morals, but maybe since all dollars that you make should be taxed, it might not have been legal. But yeah, I would consider that an honest buck.
It may well have been trade. He could have been, compensated by, coffee, tobacco, whatever. I mean, they've got products they sell at this convenience store.
Maybe given a gift. Well, that might be the legal way to do it. Instead of paying you the minimum wage that I'm required by law and getting all your background stuff, you help me and I'll give you a gift. Okay.
Hey, it's some of the easiest exchanges to facilitate and often very, very productive. I have another friend who he's homeless. I'm actually camping with him over the holidays. I've left the downtown area where I've been camping just to get a little more peace of mind. So I'm camping with a fellow that's been busy. Helping do some asphalt sealing some asphalt for some snowbirds that have needed done, and it's honest work. There's all sorts of work out here, and people that are seeking it, well, they find it, and it's just the kind of security that our society, kind of the ideal, which is a full-time job with some security and some benefits. And that's becoming rarer. There's honest work, and it's just real challenging. Shoot,
I just wanted to step in here real quick, Ken, and let our listeners know that I posted the Canhandlers Co-op on Facebook. I posted a link on our Rational Propaganda Media site. Also, we did an interview a while back that I shared where you talk about an uncomfortable subject about urination and also other homeless issues. And we also have a little bit of Junior Morris had a few things to say in our interesting conversation that day. And I think we spoke prior to the time of you starting the co-op here. So that's great.
Thank you very much.
No, thank you, sir. One of the things I like to do with this show, the idea is to kind of break the skin and get to understand a little more to the story. Like, we've been friends all our life. Let's get more than just the surface of what's going on. Sounds like you're definitely spending your time and effort and doing a lot of hard work to make a positive impact in the world that we share. So thank you very much, Ken. Thank you very much, sir.
Well, you're welcome. It's a privilege.
Is there anything else that you want to wrap up on this interesting conversation tonight? And at this time, anything else sticking in your mind that you might want to share or get the word out on people? To people?
Well, yeah, it's just an interesting observation, kind of playing off of Lewis had spoke of the community's lack of engagement with the political process. He talked about putting politics aside and getting out here and building community. And though I agree with him, politics is getting what we need as a group. Now, the simulation of politics, this game that's the red-blue corporate-sponsored show that's passively played on the living room couch.
The game of party politics, okay.
It's not a participatory, except for, I mean, most of it is passive. Most of it is designed to serve up these buffet options, and it, no matter what happens, the corporate sponsor wins. But
Do you think it's resulting in a divide and conquer kind of thing where it keeps us more divided and more away from actually going out in your community in real life and making a distance?
We seem to be perfectly divided of those actively involved in partisan politics. We seem to be perfectly divided down the middle, to where there's just about as many for the red corporate-sponsored team as there are for the blue corporate-sponsored team. And I don't think it's an accident or a coincidence. It's you can take a whole basket full of issues, some of which you don't care very much about, some of which are core to who you are, and you can pick the exact right side if you self-identify blue. I can pick the exact right side of a whole list of issues, many of which I don't care or have any experience with. But these issues have changed over time and will continue, I imagine, to change over time. But yeah, I think it's specifically designed to keep us pretty well divided when, for the most part, we all have everything in common.
I agree.
In terms of our needs, in terms of what threatens those needs, in terms of the various crises we may be facing, and in terms of how to solve that. Yeah, we got everything in common.
My plea to humanity is: let's keep the sports games and the team picking and the that kind of stuff to sports and football and stuff like that. Get this pick a team and root for your team and keep it out of politics. Let's quit playing games, people. Let's start helping people. Let's focus on that. I'm sorry, I had to rant.
I'm with you. No. I mean, and our partisan politics is very much like collegiate athletics in that, well, the Buckeyes suck. It doesn't matter what's going on with that team. Their arch enemy in their division is going to be screaming that no matter what, and it's not helpful. It might be fun in a big organized contest.
Go root a sports team. You want to have fun. You want to get angry. You want to yell, and you want to say everything that team does is wrong. Everything, and my team's the best. Go to a football game.
It's great for football.
Yeah, but it doesn't help people. People need help in our country. Let's focus on helping people. Let's quit playing games, people. Sorry. You got me. I'm getting fired up.
I'm with you. No.
Ken, I thank you for this wonderful interview, sir. It's been a pleasure to sit and, off air and talk to you and BS with you and share ideas, and I agree with you. As much as me and you can disagree on a lot of things, we agree way more on way more issues than we disagree on.
I think that the more people open themselves to letting go of ideological arguments and just finding what we have in common, we can find that we have most of what we need to focus on in common. I appreciate your efforts in bringing that to light also.
Hey, I just want to shine a little bit of light on people who are not being deterred by all the confusion and non-rational propaganda and actually doing something that helps the majority. So I'm rooting for you, Ken. I want your can handlers co-op to grow and start generating some funds for the people who need it, but also making a positive impact in our local community here. So maybe, hopefully, our city leaders will not stand in your way and encourage you and empower you to make it into a much better, more positive thing.
Thank you. Thank you, Jason. We've had a great amount of support, and I'm looking forward to growing this. And I can't see how our city leaders can avoid getting behind this project, just because Tucson is we self-identify as a green city. We recycle. And it's important to us. And I say that us, our whole community. At a time when corporations are getting on board, realizing, hey, our survival depends upon being green, it's time to do this. And I'm really glad that you're helping spread the word, brother.
Hey, my pleasure, my pleasure. You know, we all got to do our part. We all got to do our part, depending on what we have as far as tools and our individual qualities. And, you know, that's what I think in my mind is freedom. Freedom, being able to be who you are and put it out in the world and find your own way and do it. So, Ken, rock on, my friend. Rock on. And we got about 10 minutes left on the show, so I'm going to wrap up and let you go. But it has been a complete pleasure. Please get in contact with me if there's anything else you something comes up that you want to get out there and made known. I'll be more than happy to listen to you and see what I can do to assist.
Great. Thank you very much, Jason.
Have
Aaron,
a good night,
you.
Sir.
You too.
Thank you.
Bye.
Well, that was fantastic, I thought. Ken's a very interesting guy. And I posted a video of him on our Rational Propaganda Media Facebook site that I encourage everyone to check out. He's got a big white beard with a little gray in there and the bluest eyes you ever did see. I think he would make a perfect Santa. So definitely
all
making a positive impact in the world, though, is better than even a fictional character, you know? So, Aaron,
I don't know if you heard, but we need the weather over here.
The weather?
We need a Santa to bring in something other than just the heat. We've had an unusually warm winter. The sun's still shining, and we're still probably in the 60s during the day.
Oh, you can send some of that over here if you got a problem with it, because I'll tell you, this last week we've actually had frost. Yeah, me and my wife, we went out, like I said, to the Christmas thing on Bravo Base, and the sun wasn't even down, and she was already cold. She was already cold, and I to think of urban camping out there is just, in this kind of weather, is just heartbreaking. I've lost plants this last couple of weeks because of the frost and cold and nasty stuff that we've had.
Yeah, we've had our first couple of cold days just recently.
Well, if you want more cold, I'm wishing you more cold. Just send us some more sun, because we sure could use it. We're supposed to be living in the heat. It's not supposed to be.
That was surprising to me when the first time I visited Arizona. I was surprised to find that you guys actually did get snow. Because I went up around Flagstaff and there was snow up there.
Yeah, northern Arizona is a lot different. I mean, if I wanted a colder climate, I don't have to go too far, maybe like 300 miles or so.
The same state?
Or in Tucson, I could just go up the mountain. I could go make a day trip up the mountain, and I got about 20 degrees colder in most cases. I can get up there in like 30, 45 minutes. So... And that's also very nice here, is I can enjoy the snow from the valley. I can look at the snow on the mountain, but I don't have to live in it.
What mountains do you have right in that area?
Oh, well, we're surrounded by mountains here in Tucson. We have our main big mountains that stretch across almost the whole length of the city are called the Catalina Mountains. That's where you can... drive up there through Catalina Highway, you can see awesome pictures in Arizona Highways, the magazine Catalina Highway. And then the other mountains, off to the east, we have the Rincon Mountains, which there's no roads going up there. There's a crap load of hiking trails. So if you can go on foot or even take a horse, you can go visit those mountains. And then we got the Tucson Mountains overlooking downtown Tucson. And then in the south, we have the Santa Rita Mountains, which are a little further south. But I've been out there camping with my wife quite a while ago. We went down to Madeira Canyon, which is a great bird watching place. I mean, you in this canyon... and you're surrounded by hundreds of birds just singing, and their songs are bouncing off the canyons. It's quite an experience. So,
I guess the ones I remember were the White Tank Mountains, which are right up there around Phoenix, because my brother was up in that area. So,
I've spent a few nights in the White Tank Mountains. There's a little camping area. So, well. We got an exciting show for you guys next week. What we're going to do is we're going to bring back the Netflix documentary bit. And this time, it's something that Aaron's picked out. I haven't seen it yet, but my wife and I are going to sit down and watch it this week. And we encourage our listeners, if they have Netflix, to go out and see it as well. I think you can even see it on YouTube. What's it called, Aaron?
It's called Virunga.
Virunga?
Virunga.
Virunga. Is that some weird disease?
No, it's a wilderness park in the Congo in Africa. It's got the last wild mountain gorillas live there.
So. And it's a 2014 documentary. So we're getting out of the States and we're gonna go into Africa. And find out what's going on there. Great.
Belgian Congo, I believe. It's the Belgian Congo, central Africa, like right in the middle somewhere.
Okay. Well, that's definitely. I did see the preview, and it definitely looks like a great documentary. So I'm excited to watch that this week, and we encourage our listeners to check it out yourselves. And please, anytime, feel free to call in and give your opinion, or if you happen to watch the documentary, we want to hear from you. So
we can stop
on that,
by our Facebook page.
Yeah, definitely. And we got to wrap it up tonight. Gosh, I could just sit and rap with you all night, but I guess we better save some of my energy for next week. But,
yeah.
Aaron, thank you again for co-hosting, man. And, we want to hear from our sponsors. But that pretty much causes a show. City governments, national governments, come on, people. Let's quit playing games. If we have people in the community, the people of America, if we're out here trying to help each other, and if the homeless want to help themselves, step back. Quit playing games. Encourage them. Encourage people to help each other and help themselves. Put tools in there that promotes it and doesn't stop it. And go ahead, Aaron.
If you want to do something, do it. Don't think about it. Don't talk about it. Just do it.
Yeah, get in a vision. Don't be scared. If you have something that you feel that you have to do with your life, life is too short. Swallow that fear and get out there and make a positive impact in this world we live in. That's the best rational propaganda I could tell anybody.
I agree, buddy.
I think with as bad and as depressing and mundane and crazy this life is, I want people to do something positive and let's start generating that positivity, because it may just be a philosophical thing, but I believe you reap what you sow. And if you put positivity out there and you help people lift themselves up and you allow that to happen, it's only going to come back. Well, that calls it a night. I'm done with my ranting. Aaron, you have a good night, my friend, and we'll be talking to you next week.
All right, you too, buddy. Bye, guys.
Bye, everybody.
The Arizona Daily Independent, the oldest member of the American Daily Independent News Network, is proud to present this portion of Red Pill Approved Radio. The Arizona Daily Independent, along with the other members of the ADINN, welcomes citizen journalists willing to contribute the truth no matter the cost.
And we go down the bottom of the seventh. The Cubs leading 3-0.